whiteboard here. Yeah. So as Javi introduced me, I'm Alex. I'm on the VP10, VP9 WebM team at Google. But a lot of the work I'm presenting here was completed by my colleagues whose names are also on the slides. So the WebM project is all about trying to create royalty-free codecs. We've had some successes so far. VP8, initially we had slow uptake, but people are really excited about it in WebRTC. And it's also taken on a second life in sort of the GIF replacement scene. Like Chrome's video playbacks through the video tag, most of them that like aren't MSE are actually VP8 GIF replacements. And we also think that the sort of 10-year cycle for codecs that we did with H.264 HEVC is much too long. People replace their smartphones like every 2 years. Why do we have to wait 10 years for a new codec? So our main goal for VP10 is just better compression performance. We want this at all resolutions, not just at 4K style stuff. We could limit it to 4K and just do bigger transforms, bigger prediction, finish today and say mission accomplished, but that's not really interesting and it's not computationally feasible until AVX doubles in width again. We also sort of see that having a hardware codec for sort of the stable generation and software for the upcoming generation is a pattern that works nicely. So you can have H.264 hardware and VP9 software, and then you can have VP9 hardware with VP10 software. We were targeting a 3-year timeline for this codec, releasing at the end of next year, but the Alliance has sort of muddled things there, and now we don't know exactly when we're going to be releasing. So since not everyone works in video codecs all the time, I don't know why you wouldn't want to, but sort of for a still frame, in a nutshell, you chop up the picture into blocks, you predict each block from its neighbors, then you take the DCT or some other transform of that block, and you entropy code all of your prediction and DCT coefficients, and you have an image. Then for a moving picture, you add motion, and you can add some loop filters and things like that. On top of this, VP9 does a couple of things already that are somewhat interesting, where we have a widely variable prediction size, which is that chart on the right, 64 by 64 down to 4 by 4, either square or horizontal or vertical or rectangle pairs. Transform goes from 4x4 to 32x32. We added this crazy one-sided transform where there's no energy on either the left or the top edge, where you have strong prediction coming in. We have a lossless mode, and every variable that's written to the bitstream is contexted on something. So for the new codec, we're focusing on a couple of major areas so far, which I'm going to get to throughout the rest of this presentation. None of this is set in stone. All of it is still experimental. Maybe if history repeats itself, Adam Neuker can remove the experimental flag. So one of the first things we looked at is high bit depth internal everywhere. High bit depth internal, even when you're doing 8-bit coding, we find that you get 4 to 5% advantage for 12-bit compared to 8-bit. I'm sure Ronald wants to shoot me for even proposing using high bit depth everywhere. All right, that's good. At the same time, studio mezzanine files that are delivered to whatever services are, I'm not touching it. Are almost always coming in 10-bit or 12-bit these days. So we have those other bits, and if you're doing high bit depth internal, it makes sense to be able to very easily switch to high bit depth external. So for intra prediction, we have this new filter intra scheme where rather than just using those directional predictors that are sort of from VP8 and VP9 and H.264, instead we have this recursive filter system where you can provide a weighted function of the neighbors and predict that way. For inter prediction, VP9 uses three reference frames for your given frame. In single reference mode, you pick one of those frames. In compound mode, you pick two of them. So in VP10, we have sort of, rather than just compounding multiple inter, you can now compound intra with inter, which has some really interesting characteristics where you may have strong prediction coming in from one side, but slowly it fades to some sort of new content. And we have different ways that you can weight the edge. You can have a sort of a smooth weighting where you start out with your intra coming in from your nicely predicted edge, and you have some sort of motion on the other side, and you basically crossfade between them. Or we have more, or we have sort of sharper cliff weighting where there's only a little bit of filtering. Sort of the big problem with VP9's rectangular quad tree partitioning is that in actual video, actual objects are almost never rectangular. They're almost always round, and you can see in low bit rates when someone's head starts moving, they start dragging the background with them, and it looks awful and it's obnoxious, and we want to fix this. And so doing sort of new compound modes and new ways to simulate partitioning to chop around objects better can both increase SNR and also make things look visually a lot nicer. So we have this thing called wedge partition, where rather than just having the horizontal and vertical partitioning from the first slide I showed you, we have sort of any angle, not any angle, it's a fixed set of angles within the block. So it's still weighted on the transition, but the transition, it's a lot sharper compared to the smooth partitioning, or the smooth inter-intra. And you can wedge inter-intra, you can also wedge inter and inter. For 8x8, the wedge code books are nice and simple. They get kind of crazy as partitions get bigger. But compared to having to chop everything down and repeat prediction, you know, four times for everything, this can give really good savings if your object doesn't line up perfectly on rectangles. So I already talked about this part. Another thing that we've looked at is global motion, resurrected from the dead, sort of with, especially with pan and zoom for gaming videos. We have translation and global motion, which is fairly straightforward. I mean, you can basically do that with motion vector prediction for free anyway, so that isn't super interesting. But then we can add rotation and zoom. There's sort of two ways of going about it. You can sort of do it at a block level, or you can create distorted reference frames and predict from those. But right now, it's only really useful with either externally provided motion or with very artificial motion. So we have this new somersault super transform, where your transform size can be bigger than your prediction size. This is useful for cases where essentially what your residual is just grain or noise or something like that, where you don't really want to re-specify that all the time. You wind up having to filter the internal block edges before providing the residual then, which gets a little bit expensive. And there's some questions about how much of the gains are really from the bigger transformer, just from the filtering. So VP9 uses DCT exclusively for inter. It doesn't use that ADST, that's only for intra. So we brought the ADST to intra, and now we have flipped ADST, where you can have strong prediction on the, or strong residue on one edge and weak residue on the other edge. For the decoder, this is really nice because it's virtually zero overhead. For the bitstream, it's just a couple of flags that tend to be contexted really nicely, so that works well, but it's pretty expensive on the encoder. Right now, we don't have a good way to sort of do weighted motion search and unweighted motion search at the same time, so that's a real problem. We're also looking at bigger transforms, and rather than just doing a 64 by 64 DCT, doing a 64 by 64 DWT, one iteration down to sort of your 32 by 32 blocks, and then DCT coding the base of that, which we've had a little bit of luck with. That's only partially merged right now. So we have this thing called copy mode, where you can sort of copy a whole bunch of the prediction modes from a neighboring block, not just try to predict the motion individually and try to hope that your contexts line up nicely. It's especially good where you have where sort of two blocks are very similar, not just structurally, but or not just visually, but in the way that they're encoded. Like you want to use the same prediction, and it does overlap a lot with motion vector prediction, where already we say that we have this mode called nearest MV for the block above here, and by default this is a very cheap vector to code. But if you're not looking at your immediate neighbor, then it can become more interesting. So VP9 obviously has a deblocking filter. VP10 has a new nonlinear loop filter that can be used after deblocking. It's currently a bilateral filter. There's experiments going on with adaptive Wiener filters right now, but nothing concrete from those. So I mentioned a little bit about the 64 by 64 transform before the wavelet version. There's also a non-wavelet version. Beyond just doing the wedge partition expansion, we now have these sort of T-shaped partitions where you can get one big section on the left-hand side but not have to repeat yourself, but still go down smaller on the right-hand side, or vice versa. Those only get fairly modest gains. Most of the tools we have only get modest gains. There haven't been any sort of magic bullets so far, but if you add enough of them up, you can get some pretty substantial gains, which we'll show later. We also have support for much smaller tiles and random access tile support that have some advantages for VR and light field applications. We did do a bunch of optimization for screen content. We have a palette-based coding now, where for cases where you have very complex shapes but only a handful of colors, like a lot of screen content, we're using a k-means clustering to try to choose our palette, and we sort of wind up transmitting palette indexes contexted on the four neighboring pixels that get combined in sort of an interesting way. We treat this as a replacement for traditional intra prediction. We also have non-transform coding, where if visually your signal is very compact, it's going to get spread out in the DCT domain, and you're going to get that beautiful ringing, which looks worse on my screen than there, but I'm sure you've all seen JPEGs of images where there's all kinds of garbage around the text. It works really well with screen content videos. It also actually works really well on natural videos. It has small gains on regular natural videos, but it turns out that nobody really watches Park Joy except for people in this room. And real videos have watermarks overlaid, and like there will be some text overlaid somewhere at some point on a lot of videos, corrections. Like if I just misspoke here and put this video online, it may very well be saying, some text stamped on the screen saying that everything I'm saying here is wrong, and go look at this other thing instead. It also frees you up to do iterative in-loop prediction, where rather than just, say, horizontally predicting the whole block, you horizontally predict the left column, and then you add your non-transformed pixels and horizontally predict the next column after that. And that whenever non-transform coding is used and we have horizontal or vertical prediction, we switch to this because it gives better results. We also have a intra-motion sort of feature where the idea is that interframes are generally much, much smaller than keyframes because you can predict whole areas well from the previous frame. But when you're doing an intra frame, when you're halfway through the frame, you already have half of a video buffer where there may be something interesting there. This gives fairly big gains on screen content. It's not really useful on natural content. But the idea is you just search nearby in the previously coded area, find a displacement vector instead of motion, because it's not really moving. It's just a copy. So I have a bunch of slides with results here. They're not super legible from far away, so I'm just going to kind of skip ahead a little bit and say that on low resolutions, we do have some gains on what we call the DIRF LR set, which is scaled down versions of Tim's clip repository from ZIF.org. On natural content, we have some pretty big gains overall because we didn't really attempt to touch natural content at all in VP10 or screen. This is natural. Ignore what I just said. This is natural content. We do natural content in VP9, but on sort of these medium resolution videos, you know, we're seeing about 10% smaller overall. That's 480p. For screen content, which is what I thought I was talking about here, you know, we're seeing 25% on stuff that is fairly screen-like. SC Robot is this weird graphics clip from MPEG that isn't screen content at all. I don't know why they call it screen content. It's not natural, but it's not screen. But for actual screen content, we're quite a bit smaller. This is just comparing 8-bit to 8-bit and not even including the high-bit depth internal. So overall, yeah. This slide here is comparing on the right-hand column VP9 to X264, and on the left-hand column VP10 to X264. So you can kind of see how much additional savings we're getting. So, on Akio, we're 7% additional gains on top of VP9 compared to X264. So, we're finding low resolution to be the hardest sets to get gains on, which isn't really surprising. There's more signaling overhead for everything at low resolution, and bigger transforms generally don't help at low resolution. We think we're about 10% better BD rate versus VP9 on low resolution, 11% better at 480p, 20% better on screen coded, on screen content. Overall, we think this puts us about half to a third, probably closer to a third of the way to having something that we could release as a new codec from a compression performance point of view. So yeah, there's a long way to go. We still definitely need some new ideas. Extending the current tools we have that I've presented here aren't really going to get us there. We're playing with a new entropy encoder now that should have much faster decode performance so that we can include some more computationally expensive things in the codec, hopefully. So far, right now we have a public V10 directory in our master branch where we're merging stable tools. We have a public next-gen branch, which includes all of the experimental things that I've presented here, and a next-gen V2 branch with a new set of experimental tools based on a more recent fork point. But everything I presented here is available in the public now for you to play with and download and break. We're trying to do all of our VP10 development in the open this time and not just have a private branch that we make public a couple of weeks before releasing. We're trying to find any external contributors who are kind of interested. You can join our mailing list, which isn't super active, honestly, Really just scanning our patch tracker is really the best way to figure out what's going on in VP10 these days. And that's it. Ronald?
Where T partitions, do the small square subpartitions, do they decompose further?
Yes, the small parts can decompose.
And for the motion vector prediction that you mentioned, are you guys going to allow selecting which motion vector you want to reference for the difference?
So for, like, are you talking about?
So currently, for coding like an actual new motion.
Oh, vector, for actual motion vector prediction.
As a reference, right? Which is kind of funny because you can actually specify that the difference should be zero, which is the same as nearest. So it'd be nice if I could actually select the reference to be coded.
Yeah. So we had one experiment where we only had one motion mode, and after that, you could choose what reference you wanted to use of the. Available references, but that didn't really have good gains. Instead, we have a version now where you can do where you can code a new vector versus your near predictor rather than your nearest predictor.
Okay, that's what I meant.
Okay. I thought that being able to choose sort of any of the available reference vectors and code new motion on top of that seemed like it would have been interesting, but it didn't really seem to help. Anything else? Guillaume?
How much gain do you get on HD natural sequences? Because the biggest you saw was, you showed was like 480p, I think, on the cat sequences.
Yeah, so VP10 is pretty slow right now. We haven't done too much testing. And so I don't really have current numbers on HD performance gains. Also right now, some of the bigger transform stuff is still very much unfinished work. So really, before you do serious comparisons on HD and larger sizes, you want to have that stuff landed. Vlad had a question?
After listening to the AAC talk, is there something in the video world comparable to SBR that could be used?
So it seems like what VNOVA is doing is fairly similar to SBR, where the people definitely are playing with the idea of downscaling the video and having a guided upscaler, which is essentially how SBR works in audio. Kieran?
One and a half questions, I guess. Maybe you showed it and I missed it, but do you have any numbers for 12-bit precision, internal precision versus 10-bit precision? Does it actually make a major difference? And then kind of on that point again, when you've done your 12-bit comparison, I don't really know what the right answer is, but are you comparing with X264 doing 10-bit precision internally as well?
So our 10-bit comparison, 12-bit comparison, is versus the same codec at that precision. We found pretty big gains switching to 10-bit. Yeah, 3 to 4, which I guess we consider big these days, and only a little bit more switching to 12-bit. We haven't done any comparisons right now where we're doing 10-bit external, 12-bit internal, where I would expect to see some gains.
Okay. And are your tests with X264 10-bit or with X264 8-bit? I don't know what the right answer is because 8-bit is used in the real world, but then you're not doing a like-for-like test, really. I don't really know what the right answer is.
For the test that we had versus X264 there, those were basically 8-bit because that's the only thing used in the real world, and that's where most of the hardware we deal with is 8-bit only. All right. Last question.
How do you plan to integrate HDR? Is it going to be inside the codec or as a side channel?
Oh God, someone could give a whole like hour-long talk on HDR, but right now, basically, the codec, it seems like the plan is that the codec will give some help to the HDR system by having higher bit depth, but then you're still going to have information in the side channel. JB?
Yeah, I've got a question. Do you plan to make it like open source, or like Google open source, or VideoLAN open source, or open source?
So I'm hoping that some of our alliance partners may pull us into a more open development model. Right now, definitely, at the very worst, it will be, let's call it Android open source. But right now, we'll be...
No, I meant more like at the end, when the codec is finished, is it possible to have a spec and to have, like, put it on different formats?
Yes.
And, you know, like...
That's why we're there, to make sure they don't screw it up.
Okay. You know, I've been complaining about that since so much, but one of the reasons no one wants to use VP9 is because of that. You can't put it in MP4, MKV, you don't know if it's official and or not. Same for TS and so on. I complained to your boss already, seriously. This
so
is ridiculous.
JB, there's some change coming on that part.
Wow. And are they going to put on the WebM project VP9 or is it
VP9? VP9, there's a change coming. You talk about it. For VP10, there is a talk to move it.
I mean, sorry for trolling, but seriously.
I actually agree with you a lot. It becomes a big corporate politics and various legal opinions sort of thing and not a decision that I can make. If I could release a VP9 spec today, I would. If I could release an MP4 mapping today, I would.
Jeffy, don't forget, he's here. He's actually talking in public. This is better than what we've had for previous.
Yeah.
I mean,
if I wasn't complaining today about that, you would be disappointed, so my point is made. Thanks so much.